prototyping, so that's the first one, where we will be looking at some basic tools, which are HTML and CSS, and then we are going to build up on that knowledge. But first of all, I would like to give you a bit of feedback about the first three activities and then the last activity. So it's not great. I should say I'm a bit disappointed. If we look at, for example, activity one, only 135 of you have submitted. The final, really final deadline is next week. There will be no extension, nothing, not worth asking. And we are a class of around 190. So it means that 60 of you haven't engaged, I would say, in the class, which is quite a large number. So that's not good. If we look at activity two, it's not very good either. You know, 100 out of 190. And activity three, it's very poor. I mean, I'm going to be lenient about activity three because I know that people have had problems with their domain providers and so on. So it takes a bit more time. So I'm not going to shout too loud about that number. But I would expect this number to go much higher next week. Otherwise, it means that there's a serious problem. So it means that there are around 50 people who are doing everything well in this class, okay, which are already with 12% as a mark for the module, which means that with a bit of, if they carry on like that, by Christmas they will have passed the module. So they will have a quite relaxed holidays. On the other hand, some people will be really much behind. And it will not be too late, but starting to become worrying. So please be more active, because everything is building up on the previous activities. Last week you had to get the domain, some space somewhere. This week you have to build a website from scratch. If you don't have a domain to upload it, I will not be able to mark it. Okay, so you shouldn't be too much behind the rhythm of the activities. Okay, so just a final reminder, the first activity final deadline is in 1 week. Okay, I think people who have done it didn't find it too difficult. It's just to get you going. So please, I would like to have 100% of people completing that activity. Okay, so specifically to about activity three, I mean, there are some general questions. Are we going to have a survey every week? And the question, the answer is yes. I think you have understood the dynamic of the course. Some people contacted me saying, I haven't got my marks yet. So the rules of the games are very simple. If you submit for the first deadline, I mark them and I give you some feedback very early so you can submit again if it's not at the right level. If you pass the first deadline, you will have to wait for the end of the final deadline when I will be marking your work. Okay. So I should remind you that the rule is after a deadline, academics have 3 weeks for marking your work. Okay. So until 3 weeks after the deadline, you may be waiting for your results. Usually I'm faster than that, but if you submit it between the first and the second deadline, you have to wait for the time after the second deadline. So I received many people saying I haven't received a receipt. Okay. So generally the problem is not me, it's you. Okay. And the most common problem is that people don't know how to spell Kingston. I mean, that's real submissions, okay? Or they get confused in their heads, okay, between the Kingston account and their Hotmail, Gmail, and so on, okay? So make sure that when you write an email address is the correct one, otherwise you are not going to get a receipt. Okay. I am not going to reply anymore to people saying I haven't received a receipt. Okay. It's your responsibility to put the right email address. If you don't get a receipt, but I receive the work, it's not a problem. Okay. I will mark it and you will get the mark as you should have. But that's a very important field on the form. So some people found this whole process of getting a domain and space on the server a bit difficult. They had to reinstall WordPress a couple of times because it didn't work the first time. That's part of the process. You know, that's what about being an IT professional. You don't succeed always the first time. You try again and again, and eventually it worked. So, and I should say that out of the submissions, I think only one person didn't pass the first activity. And it's just because I couldn't access the website, because for some reason they clicked the wrong button and they closed it. Okay. So this activity is not that difficult. You just follow the process and you get it. You know, it's a bit like setting up a Facebook account. Okay. You can make a lot of mistakes, but at the end you get it, and if you get it, it's just working. Okay. So please do this activity because it's really essential for this course. And as you're learning as an IT professional, it's very important as well. I had some personal questions somehow. People are asking me if I have a blog. I don't have a blog. However, I've had a website for more than 10 years. Okay, so I'm active on the web. I'm using my own website where usually I share about my research activities, so it's only professional things. If we look for it, my website, so you can learn everything about my research activity in bioinformatics, in computer vision, more about computer vision. You can get my list of publications, so you have all my 2015 publications. So I try to update my website at least once a month, so it's always up to date. And if you go through different things, you will find videos and stuff. Okay. So hopefully it looks professional, and what is important is it's complete, it's updated. You know, it's not, yeah, I haven't touched it for 5 years and everything is irrelevant. Okay. But that's the most annoying thing. You go to a website and you see that it's out of date. So you need to make sure that always up to date, and when people come back regularly they get some new information. Some people were surprised that when they signed for some space on the server, there was a limit on the number of visitors. Do you know why?
Because they want more money.
Yeah, so why does it cost more to get more visitors?
Because it's bundled, they pay for bundles.
Yeah, you pay for bundles. When you pay for a service, so you have the quality of the service, they have a helpline and so on. There is the amount of space they are going to keep on their server, and they are going to archive regularly and so on. And then there is a pipe. Okay. How much bandwidth is it going to cost to access your website? So you have a website such as the BBC, which is accessed by millions of people. You can imagine you need a big pipe. If you have a small website where 10 people go every day, you don't need the same requirements. So when you are paying for a web presence, they want to make sure that you are not going to monopolize all the bandwidth of that server. Okay, so that's why you have to pay. So it's not only that bad guy wants to make money, is that, you know, if you take all the bandwidth, then nobody else can access other websites. So can you make money out of a website? Of course, and Pushpa will tell you more about e-commerce and all these things. So obviously the first step is to have a good website. Because if it looks rubbish, nobody's going to try to give you any money for it. Okay. Obviously, you can do money through many channels. One is obviously e-commerce, selling stuff. Second one is publicity. Okay, that's what YouTube is doing. So if your website is popular, if it has a positive image, it's likely that you can attract advertisers. Okay, so people got really interested in many technical aspects as well. You know, how does subdomain creation is done? How can I be more proficient in WordPress? How is FTP implemented? Question also about personal information and so on. So they are all very good questions, and we are not going to address them within this course. Okay, WordPress, you know, it's not undergraduate level. In principle, you can learn that on your own. So we are not going to spend more time on WordPress. So if you are interested in, go on the web, get some tutorials, and learn about it. And you can learn by yourself. You don't need a lecturer for that. All the aspects of networking protocols and so on, you are going to have a module on that. Okay, so we are doing it quite superficially this year, but you will go in depth about that. Personal information as well, it's something which is extremely important, getting more and more important, but it's not in this course where we are going to do in the depth of things. Someone spoke about SSH features, so they are very important. And when you are, because usually when you get a domain and some server space, they provide you with some kind of environment, so it's quite easy to upload and download things. But if you are a professional IT person, usually you are not very happy with that environment. You know, it's a bit too basic, you cannot do exactly what you want. You have to go through 10 steps to something you want to do directly. So that's where SSH helps you to go at a higher speed. Obviously, it's more complicated, it's more advanced, but if, again, you are serious about websites and updating them, SSH is something you should investigate. We'll be looking a little bit about that in the next lectures, but again, you will have modules which will go deeper into that. I know that finding the server locations and technical specs are quite difficult. Some providers are very transparent about it. I mean, usually when you have good specs and you are located in a prestigious place, you are going to shout about it. If it's a bit dodgy in the back of a garage, you are going to keep it quiet. So I understand that for some people it was very difficult to answer the questions. So if you cannot answer, that's okay. And finally, so that was the worst comment. So that was not from people submitting. It's more people in the corridors or knocking at my door saying, JC, what should my site be about, my blog? You know, I have no idea, help me. So, we are going to go through some of the blogs that you have created, okay? Some that I've liked, and hopefully that will inspire the people who didn't have any idea. Okay, so there was this one, so that's quite a serious blog. So, so in remembrance of a parent who used to be an evangelist. So, you know, they are taking an opportunity of this blog to do something they are really keen about and they are interested in it, and hopefully she's going to do some greater good. So great usage of the blog. Some people followed my advice of, yeah, if you feel that you want to start being known as an IT specialist, start speaking or discussing about IT topics. Okay, so here there is something about Microsoft against Apple, so that's a little war which has been going on for decades, and more contributions. So that's good, that's something I like as well. Some people went more into their private hobbies, so people are into reading and wanted to recommend some books. Again, it looks very nice, you professionals, great. What else? A few people took the option about using the blog as a personal journal to speak about their experience either in IT Toolbox or their life at uni and so on, which is great as well. And obviously you will get a lot of interest from people from the university, maybe not so much outside. Maybe your parents will be very happy to know how you feel, especially if you feel good and you don't speak too much about what happens late at night. But so that's very good as well. And then some people have very specific passions. So Real of Madrid, a few people were interested actually in the same team. I was surprised. Some people are more into photography or traveling, so they are sharing about their trips. Again, people sharing about things which are personal, about why they are enjoying the gym, for example. A related theme about diets, okay, how to feel better, and some information about that. Again, a big controversy in the world of football.
Lewandowski.
Yeah, again, some people speaking about what they like and with a humorous tone. Great. People into photography, more arty things. That's a good platform for sharing their work and maybe getting some feedback from some friends. And I think, you know, if you keep it specialized, you know, it's not like Facebook where every day we get hundreds of pictures from, half of them are selfies or photos of food. So these arty photographs are a bit lost in that environment. So having a blog where you are showing your work on that thing may be a very good idea. And that's unfortunately a very common blog. I hit the name, so some people just didn't bother doing much. So there's nothing wrong with it. There's nothing wrong, and those people passed the activity. So they just set up a blog, did two test posts, and that was it. Okay. And that's okay, that's okay. And those people passed the activity, so that's fine. On the other hand, it's a bit of a missed opportunity. You know, you are provided with a tool which can do quite a lot for you, and you are not using it. Okay. But as a piece of homework, that's fine. More people into IT stuff. People about music, yeah, obviously. I don't know if it was the student himself is the artist or not, I was not sure. Some people, yeah, they found it a bit difficult, went through the different steps and eventually had a big smile. Good to see. Again, some people are more arty than others and use the blog for communicating that. and some people putting the best quotes of the day. I liked it, you know. You know, such kind of blog, if every day you have a couple of new quotes, but you need to update it regularly. That's the problem, you know. It's called the quotes of the day. If I go today and don't get a quote, I will not be happy. Okay. No, but that's true, you know. It's building a following and building expectations, you know. You're telling me a quote of the day, and there's no quote today. What's happening, you know? The end of the world or what? So, but I found it great, you know. I spent a bit of time reading the different quotes, and I liked it. Okay, so just a quick poll. So, I think the channel is 3. So, how much have you paid for getting a domain and a host? As I said last week, for around £40, you know, should get some kind of Rolls Royce. But many people manage to get it for less. And many people, you know, are a bit scared of putting some money and they have some limited budget. So I think that information would be very useful for them, so to have some ideas. Not many votes today. Has everybody voted? Everybody who wanted to vote has voted? Can we reach 50? Okay, so obviously quite a few people haven't completed the activity, but you can see that the range of prices, you know, is quite wide. A large number of people paid around the £40, which, you know, it's the easy option. You get exactly what you need, you get the right specs, and you get, it's very easy to set up everything. But a few people got it for nothing or for £5, okay? So, you know, even if you are short of money, you can do it, okay? It would be much more work, okay, but you can do it. Quite a few people managed to do it for £10, for £30, and very few paid more than £40. But I assume those people have a special need, you know, they are already running an e-commerce website, and they have specific specs, and the £40 solution was not maybe sufficient for that. So everything good. So I can see that £10, you know, it looks like a low budget solution, which seems to be acceptable because quite a few people have chosen that one. So you remember I asked you that question last week. And last week, the majority of people, if I remember well, didn't have a website. So let's see if this week the statistics have changed. Reach 60 or still building up. Okay, let's close that poll. Wow. Nice. So here were the statistics of last week. So you can see the difference. Okay. So now the majority have completed this activity. Since they had 0 last week, we know that this week they have 1, and it's this one. Okay, so obviously the one we had 1 before, so now they moved at 2. Yeah, no surprise for that. Strange that the three or more has been down, in principle it should go up somehow. But some people reused the website they had already, so that's... But that's promising, okay? So hopefully this number will go down every week and will be at zero very soon. But I'm pleased by that, okay? Now we have a large majority of students with a website. You are webmasters now. Oh. You have been upgraded. Okay. But you have become webmaster the easy way. Okay? So now we need to do it the proper way, the IT professional way. Okay. So what is a web page? Okay, that's the first question. And it has different elements. And it's important to go through the different sets of elements. So first, it has some content. So the content can be static. So each time you go to that web page, you get the same information. The information which doesn't change is the static information. Okay. So that could be the text you have entered in your on your web page, images. It can be videos that you have uploaded, or links. Okay. So that is somehow hard-coded. You are entering the information and it's there, but it's not going to evolve. Okay. People are going back to your website and that information is still the same, and if you are not updating it regularly, it starts getting boring, there is nothing new. Okay. And then there is the what is called the dynamic content, which means that new information is put on your website automatically. You don't have to do the work yourself. Okay. An example is you are going to write some clever code to say, write on your my website what is the temperature today or what is the date. Okay. Automatically, your website will be updated with that information. So that's becoming a more interesting website, because each time you go there, there is something new. I mean, getting the dates is maybe not the last, very exciting, but you can get the latest football or rugby results, okay? The latest concerts and anything you want, okay? Just by adding a bit of dynamic information, your website is much more interesting, because automatically it's going to grab some information from outside. So people outside are generating new material and you are collecting it automatically and put it on your website. Okay, so you are a bit like a filter. There's all this information out there and you, by writing some clever coding, you are retrieving the one you think that your public would be interested in. Okay, so generally that's the success of a good website. Okay, to be dynamic, to have some new information all the time. Okay, and so in order to get your dynamic website, there are two key programming languages, which are JavaScript and PHP. And we will get through the basics of those two languages during this course. Okay, you will do much more about that during your time in Kingston, but we will get you started on that on this course, which means that when you will be submitting your coursework about your website at the end of the year, hopefully you will be offering already some dynamic features on your website. So, a website is obviously content, but the content needs to be structured. Okay. And the tool that people use to structure your content on a website usually is what is called HTML. And in addition to the structure, there is what is called the style, okay? The look and feel of your website. And there's another tool, which is called CSS, which allow you to deal with that, okay? So today, we are going to assume that your website is static. We are not going to look at the dynamic feature yet. But we, as I said, we will have lectures on PHP and JavaScript coming. But we will be looking at the structure and the style of your website. So you remember this right button on your mouse, which allow you to get the source of any web page you are browsing. So we are back to the first web page ever. And if we look at the source of that web page, you can see how it looks like. So you can see that in black, somehow you have your content. In blue, you have all those different links. And in dark red, you have some keywords. And those keywords are the ones which are dealing with the structure and the feel of your website. So obviously that's technology of more than 20 years ago. It has evolved a little bit, but you are going to see that it's not that different today. Okay. It has been rationalized a bit, so now structure and appearance are separated. But apart from that, it's still very close to the initial design of HTML. Okay. Do you know what this interesting word means? Yeah. So WYSIWYG is what you see is what you get. Okay. And when you are using computer tools, some of them are WYSIWYG, some of them are not. Okay. So, for example, if you are using Microsoft Word, you are typing your code or your text inside Word, and pretty much what you see on your screen is what you will get if you were to print that file. Okay. So that's the WYSIWYG concept. However, there are plenty of tools which do not work that way. Okay, there are so the content, you know, is expressed using what is called a markup language. Okay. And you are going to use special codes to say, yeah, this sentence need to be centered. This one needs to be that color, and so on. So when you are writing, you are not specifying the color and all that stuff, but you are adding some commands saying that should be that color, that should be in the middle, and so on. So if we look at our initial website, okay, so the code of the website is definitely not WYSIWYG. Okay, you are typing what is on the left, and you are getting what is on the right. Okay, so very two different worlds. It's not when you are using your word processors, when what you type is what you get. Okay. So among the most popular markup languages, we have HTML, so the one we are going to look at today. We have XML, which somehow is an extension of HTML, which is now used for many other applications. And you have another language which is used as a word processor, but usually in the domain of edition, which is called LaTeX. Okay. So for example, this word has been written using LaTeX. Okay. You would have a lot of problems doing that with words, okay, writing that way. In LaTeX, you just write a set of commands, and you can write it that way. Okay. So LaTeX is much more powerful. Okay. So when you are going to print a book, usually the editors are moving to the LaTeX world. Okay. Because you can specify everything you want. Okay. Because in Word, you know, you can have a title in bold, and next title, you forget to put it bold, and it's not coherent. Okay. So sometimes you can get a feel which is very professional. In LaTeX, you cannot make that. Okay, you can say a comment, all my title should be of that type. You write it once, and it's applied to all your titles. Okay. So it's a very powerful tool. However, it requires learning the markup language. Okay, so it's a bit of extra work, and you need to compile the text in order to see the result. it's not just directly on your text. So it's a bit of extra work. And when you are working on short documents, it's maybe not worth the hassle. But on bigger documents, for example, if you are writing a PhD thesis of 200 pages, it's very likely that you will be using LaTeX. John, you are using LaTeX?
Yeah.
Yeah, so John is using LaTeX there, okay. When I'm publishing papers about my research, half of the time I'm using LaTeX, okay. LaTeX is particularly good for complicated stuff, so writing a word like this one, or writing equations, okay. With Word, it's a bit of a hassle to write equations and so on. LaTeX is very good for that. Okay, so let's look at HTML. So as I said, it's a markup language. It's not a programming language. So how many times do I get CVs where people claim that they know all those programming languages and they put HTML in the list? So it doesn't look serious to me. Okay. It's not a programming language. So HTML stands for Hypertext Markup Language, and it's used to describe web pages. It was invented at the time of the invention of the web by our British engineer Tim Berners-Lee in 91, and it's being updated regularly, and the current version is HTML5, and it's from last year. And another tool which is quite common, an alternative to HTML, is XHTML. As we have seen, we have XML, now this general language which allow you to do web stuff, but stuff outside the web as well. So now there has been some kind of convergence, and HTML4 is almost a subset of XML, okay, because they were designed separately and now they are merging, and so HTML4 is more or less a subset of XML, but not rigorously a subset. So if you want the perfect subset, you have to use XHTML, okay, but the similarity is very close. Think about the difference between American and British English. If you understand one, you're likely to understand the other one, except if they come from Texas. Okay. So, do you really need to know about HTML? That's the first question. I mean, some of you have built a great website with using WordPress or other content management systems. So do you really need to know HTML? I mean, first of all, you need to understand how those tools work, okay? Maybe your job in the future will be to create the next WordPress. So you really need to know what is under the hood, okay? Also, you want to have total control, okay? At the moment when you created your blog or website using WordPress, you can pick a set of themes, okay, the one you prefer. Most people choose the default one, just a black and white feel. But, you know, you have quite a nice list of themes, but I guess that if you had to imagine your own themes, it wouldn't be part of those, okay? So now, as the professional web designers do, they pick a theme, and then they adapt it, okay? They retake the WordPress files, for example, and they change it so that it's personalized, customized to their needs or the need of their clients. Okay. So if you are not able to read the commands which are used to write those themes, there's no chance you can update them. Also, it will allow you to learn how to create websites across different platforms. You will not just be based on your PC, and obviously everything which is mobile now is becoming very important. So basically, HTML is really a key to for becoming a professional web developer, and that's why we're going to spend a bit of time on it. And I will ask you to do an activity HTML based. Okay, so here is a set of commands. So it's 5 lines, and these 5 lines fully define a website. With that, I have a web page. Okay, and I have put it on my web page, which is here. Okay. That's a web page. It's not the most exciting web page around, okay, but it's a fully functional, following the HTML principles, a web page. Okay. So if we look at this very basic web page, so it's a HTML file, okay. If we look at it, it's here, okay. So I'm using a tool called Notepad++, okay. Now we are becoming IT professionals, so forget about Word and Notepad, okay. They are not good tools for doing scripting, programming, markup languages and stuff like that. You need a better tool. Notepad++, you can get it for free. There are many of them. I like more Xemacs, okay, but maybe a bit more complex to use. Notepad++ is very easy to use. And the great thing is when you open a file with Notepad++, it will recognize what language you are using. Okay, you are using HTML, you are using PHP, you are using Java, you are using C++, whatever, it does recognize it, and use some nice colors to recognize the tags, checking that every bracket which is opened is closed, and all these nice functionalities. Okay, so when you are using those text editors, it's not too difficult to program. Okay, so what I want you to do in this activity is to use that. Okay, I don't want you to use WordPress or anything. Create your own file, jc.html. Open it with a tool such as Notepad and start writing code. Okay, we don't want code from anywhere else. It's just coming from your brain through your fingers. Okay. Okay, so yeah, so you can see that the logo of Notepad++ is the chameleon, because it changes colors according to the environment. If it's a Java code, it will have the colors of Java and so on. So first of all, an HTML file is just a text file. Okay. It's not full of zero and ones or crazy stuff, it's just text, which means it's human readable. Okay, if you know the basic rules, you will be able to understand it. And you can write it. You know, you don't need a big program to generate that code. And here we are already seeing the basics of the language. You have tags, which are surrounded by the symbol superior and inferior. And you open a tag and you close a tag with a slash. Okay. So the first tag, I think, is quite self-explanatory. So this text is in this file is in HTML. Here is the start of the file, here is the end of the file. And then one another very important tag is the body tag. Okay, so that's the core of your HTML page. And so you, using the tag body, you can write some content for that page. Okay, so we said that my web page was a bit boring. Thank you. Now we are going to try to add a bit of more content. Okay, so I've tried to write some stuff. And so now if I open that page with my web browser, what am I going to get? So here I've tried to use my HTML file in a WYSIWYG fashion. However, when HTML is interpret that file, it's going to remove all that information. Okay. So if I go here, so I just write my file in HTML. I can just drag it into my browser. Browser is going to understand it. Yeah, it's an HTML file. It's using those tags, so I know what to do. But as you can see, all the formatting that I tried to add in my text has been lost. Okay. Because it's a markup language, all the formatting has to come from tags. It's not where the words are placed, it's where I tell them to be placed. Okay. So here are my body tags, but inside I don't have any tag regarding the structure, so my HTML interpreter is not understanding anything about the texture, structure. So you need to learn about some basic structure types. Okay. So here we have, let's say, the same web page now with a bit of structure. So we can see that now we have section names. We have a list. I have stuff which is in bold. I've added a picture. I have added a link. And now I can even start a link which allows me to send emails. Okay, so I have already some interesting features on that. And we are going to look at what tags are used in order to do that kind of stuff. But we can see that here I'm just speaking about structure. I'm not worrying about the look, how it feels, okay, the style. There's no style at the moment, it's just content and a bit of structure to organize it in a relevant way. Okay, so if we look a little bit inside that body tag, so first of all I have a header, and that's a header of level 1, so that's the first level, okay. So in principle, it's going to be bigger than the text in the other header. And so it's a header of level 1, so the tag is H1. Simple enough. And then I have a header on level 2, and it's H2. Then I want to have a list with made out of bullet points. So I have this tag ULIST, which is unnumbered list, so it means it's bullet points. You can also have a list with numbers for each items. And here we have the different elements of my list. Here is the tag in order to have an image. Okay, so the image tag. We note that here you are not closing the tag. Okay, the image is in one place, it doesn't start and end anywhere. So you need to provide the source. Where is that image? So where is it on your server, for example? So you need to understand where your files are placed on your server. But you can also use a source which is on another website. And in that case, you provide a full HTTP reference. And then you have to provide, if you wish, the size of your image. Okay, so you can format it so that it fits according to your needs. Here, it's a tag for getting a new line. The I tag is to get things in italic. Again, and here I have a link. Link, it means that I am using the href tag. And when you have a link, you have the place that you are clicking on, which will lead you to the link. So this link will be activated when I click on the NASA world. It can be a word, it can be an image, it can be anything you want. Okay. And then I have this tag P for creating a new paragraph. So you can see that most of the tags are quite easy to use. Okay, here we have the basic ones. Obviously, there are hundreds of them. Okay, so we are not going to go through each of them during this class. That wouldn't make much sense. So in the activity, you are going to go and investigate a few of them. And generally, the rarest one, you will be looking for them when you really need them. There is no point getting this long list, whereas in general you always use a list of 20, and that does most of the job. Or when you are going to be editing, let's say a WordPress HTML page, you will say, oh, I understand 90% of the tags, there are a couple of tags I don't know, you do your research, and say, oh, okay, I know now what they do, and you know how to edit it. Okay. But the main principles are there, and you can see it's quite straightforward. Okay. Not as easy as using Word, but still, you know, you don't need a degree in IT to generate some HTML. So at the moment, we don't have any style. Okay, we just have content and structure. Style, obviously, is very important if you want to make your website attractive and get people coming back to it. So in the past, so at the time of the creation of the web, there were also tags for the style. Okay. So as part of HTML, you had some code for the style. So you have this this tag, for example, font, and you say, yeah, I want a Verdana of size 6, color red, and everything which is between the font open tag and the font close tag will be of that style. Okay, so that was the old-fashioned way of doing it. So you can imagine it's a lot of work, because each time I have a header of first level, I need to copy that information about the font. Okay, so first it's a lot of work. And secondly, I am at risk of not being consistent. You know, at some point, I will forget about writing this header, this information about the header. Or I'm going to do some copy and paste from another website, and now I'm going to go use a completely different font for another header. Okay. Which means that your website doesn't look very consistent, doesn't look very professional, and so it's a very strong weakness. Secondly, when you want to update your website, you know, you say, okay, the fashion of writing with Verdana has passed. Okay, I mean, Google has changed their logo recently. They had one font and now they have a new font. Okay. I mean, it would be a lot of work to go through all the web page and change the type of font. So another reason for separating the style from the structure. Let's have a unique file telling me everything about style. I can keep the same structure, the same content, but change the style in an instant. So for example, if you look at this web page, since I have full control using old-fashioned HTML that your browser can still understand, you can see that I was able to have two headers which are supposed to be at the same level with different colors, different fonts, different styles. Okay. And that doesn't look like a professional website. I think. So I guess that when you are doing something a bit edgy, a bit arty, that's maybe a good thing to have full control and break some rules. Okay, that's part of creativity. But usually, following the rule, having something consistent is what you want.
So when you're programming, when you're using HTML, you have to write in American, because that's
Unfortunately, HTML use American keywords. So yeah, color is with a spelling mistake. Yeah, you will find that a lot in programming, in Java, in everything. The American English is leading in the world of IT, so it's a bit annoying sometimes. You know, you are creating a variable which is my color, you write it C-O-U-R, and then the type of that variable is color without a U, and it's a bit horrible, but that's life. Okay, so when we are speaking about style, we are using another language now, which is not HTML anymore. It's called CSS. So CSS stands from Cascading Style Sheets. Okay, so it's a style sheet language that you will be using with HTML in order to provide style to your document. And as I said, it allows you to separate style from content and structure. Okay. So for example, here is one website. You know, so here I'm using a style sheet, a very specific style sheet. And here is the same website using a completely different style sheet. The HTML file hasn't changed. It's just the style that I've associated to my HTML page is completely different. Okay. And you can see that the effect looks radically different. Both look very annoying, but it's just to make a point. Okay. Here I look like a 13-year-old girl, okay. And here more like a heavy metal teenager, let's say. So the only difference between those two websites is that now I've used a tag which is head. Okay, we have seen the tag which is body, which is where your content and your structure is going. But you also have a tag which is called head, where, for example, I'm going to put the title of my web page. Okay, usually in your browser, you can see the titles of web pages, or you can have a small icon for your web page. So it's part of the head tag where you provide this information. And the tag obviously is very simple. For the title, it's title. And then it's here where I'm linking my website to a style sheet. Okay. So this one I call it spring.css. So I'm telling, yes, when the browser is going to interpret my HTML, please use that style sheet in order to stylize my document. Okay. So in order to get the style sheet on the left, I will link to one file. If I want the style sheet on the right, I link to another file. So as we have seen, I mean, actually there are two ways of using CSS. The first one is, as we have seen, in part of the head tags, I'm going to have a link to a specific style sheet. Again, it can be on your website, or it can be the style sheets of somewhere else. I mean, it's not recommended to use a style sheet of someone else, because they may change it, and your website looks odd. And the style sheet itself looks like that. Okay. So So it's this style sheet, which allowed me to get this style. And it's very simple. It's roughly 10 lines. So I have some general information. So I want the background of my website to be aquamarine, okay? I want the color of the text, the general text, to be pink with a font of size 22, and I want that font to be Arial, and I want the text to be centered. Okay, so that's what we get here. Everything is centered. The standard text is in pink, Arial font, and the background is aquamarine. Again, notice that center is using the American spelling. and then for each header, I'm going to give some instructions. So I'm going to say that for header of level 1, I want it to be of color indigo. The font should be bold, size 142, and that's the type of curly font that I want. And for level 2, the only thing I change is the size. Level 3, I change the size again, and level 4, the size again. Okay. So that's my style sheet. You know, it's not rocket science. It's even easier than HTML. I'm just, for each type of text which will be on my web page, I provide some information of how I want it to be displayed. Another way of using CSS is actually not to link to a sheet which is on a file, but just to write the content inside the header tag. Okay. So I just have a tag saying, here is my style in of type CSS, and here are the information for the style. So now you have understood the basics of CSS. No, it's not rocket science. But why is it called cascade? I mean, we understand why it's style sheet now. Okay. But why is it cascade? Yeah? Yeah, because we have already seen, and we have seen three types of way of giving style to a page. Either you do it the old-fashioned one, with it using some old HTML tags, or you can have it inside the head part, or you can have it in a file which is outside. Okay. So why can we do it three ways? Okay. And what happens if you mix things up? So that's the strength of this environment, HTML, CSS, is that you can be in full control and choose which bit of style you prefer. Okay? So that's why it's called a cascade. It's a whole hierarchy. You can specify style at any level you want. Inside the content, using HTML tags, inside the head, or inside the file. And your browser has a set of rules to know how to style your page. So the first rule of your browser is to say, if there are some HTML tag about style, they are the one which are going to win. So if you force a tag, a sentence to be of a special color, a special font, by putting the right tag in HTML, that would be what you get. You can have all the style sheets you want, that's going to override it, because you specified this one needs to be different from the style sheet I've provided. This one will be that color. Okay? So that's the strongest indication of style. If you hard code it, inside your HTML. The second one is the style which is in the head. Okay, that's the second strongest one because it's the closest. It's always the proximity to your text. Okay, if it's in the text, it's the number one. If it's in the head, it's still quite close to the text. It's number two. Okay, so you can have a style sheet and you can have style within the head. If there are contradictory information, is the style in the head which is going to win. Okay. Then there is a style that you can link to a file, okay, which will be the third level of styling. And finally, there is a style that your browser is going to give by default. Okay. If you don't provide any styling information, it's still going to display your text. Okay. So the browser has a styling sheet, the default one. There is the one you can have. There is the information you can have in your head and the information you have in your HTML code. Okay. So why do you have all those levels? Okay. So first of all, it's good to have a default style sheet because as you can imagine, in CSS, you can have hundreds of commands. When you are creating your style sheet, you know, you are thinking about what is important, and you are not going to define everything because there are commands you are unlikely to use and something like that. So you are going to define your style sheet with the important styling information, but what you are not defining will be coming, will be inherited from the default style sheet of your browser, okay? So you don't have to do all the work, you do just the work of what is important. Similarly, usually you are going to have a website which will have many pages, and you want your website to be consistent, so you will have all the page linking to the same style sheet, okay? That's generally how people use it. However, you may have a page where you want to change things a little bit. So you are going to redefine some elements of the style. You're not going to redefine everything, but you say, hey, yeah, here I want the header not to be indigo, I want them to be red because it's a very important page or whatever. So you are going to link to the style sheet, but in the head, you are going to add some new CSS instructions saying, hold on, here, header are going to be in red. So which means that when your browser is reading, it says, okay, he wants headers to be in red, but there's no information about the font. Where can I find information about the font? Let's look in the file. Oh, there's information in that file about the font, so I'm going to be red with that file, with that font. If there's no information about the font in the file which is linked, it's going to be using the default one. And then you have the last level, okay? Here we were speaking about a website which is consistent, which is just a page which is a bit different. But sometimes you want in that different page a particular sentence to be a bit different. And there you are going to use some HTML tags to override, again, some aspect of styling. But any aspect of styling that you are not providing at what level, your browser is going to look at the level above, and if it doesn't find it, it goes above and above until it reaches the default style sheet. Yeah? That clear? So you can see that it's very powerful. You can really go and be creative, or you can play in safe. Okay, you generate your nice style sheets, link everything there. And it's fine. But that's the difference between a website which is created by WordPress and the one which is done by a professional. The professional can play with all those things. They may use the WordPress style sheet, but for each page they will change it slightly, or maybe change the style sheet, or change for each page or specific items in your web page. Okay. Okay. So we spoke about basic content. We spoke about structure. We spoke about style. Just as a preview, okay, we are not going to spend much time on that. I would like to speak about dynamic content because that's really what makes a website alive. And usually it allows you to interact with the website or to get new information coming without having to edit your HTML files. And as we said, we have scripting languages which are going to be added within your HTML. And we spoke about JavaScript, PHP, and then we have this framework called Ajax that we will go through as well. What is important to understand is how a web page is interpreted, okay? Because you have your own machine and you are going to try to retrieve a web page which is coming from a specific address, okay? So you are going to do a request and say, yeah, I would like to access www.co.uk. Okay, you click on it and you are conversing with the server, which may be very far away, and the server is going to return you what you asked for. And depending on the nature of the website, the work of the server is going to be quite different. So if you are asking for an HTML page, the server is going to send you back the HTML page. And your server, your browser is able to understand this HTML, okay? So that's why when I open my browser and I have a file here, which is in HTML, made some exciting special effects on my file. So that's a styling effect as well. My browser understands it. Okay, the server, in that case, just send me the file and all the hard work is done on my machine. And that's the case when you are working with HTML, CSS, or when you are using JavaScript, because your browser understands JavaScript as well. Okay, so it sends you back the file and your browser is doing all the work. However, so we are going to look at an example of an exciting web page with some JavaScript. Okay, so now I have added a calculator on my web page. Okay, so now my web page is dynamic. Each time you go there, you can do something a bit different. Okay, I mean, obviously, this calculator is not the most exciting stuff to do, but you can see that you can run programs where the user can enter some data and you get some outcome, and it's becoming a more interesting web page. Okay, so that bit is basically made using JavaScript. So basically, no surprise, I have in my head tags, I'm saying, oh, I'm going to use a file which is written in JavaScript. And what that file does is to calculate things. Okay, so here there is some proper programming, and I'm calling that code to be used within my HTML page. So if we look at my HTML page, I have all that code, which is HTML, where basically I'm designing the look of the calculator, and I'm creating buttons, okay? On click, and when I click on the button 8, I call a function, which is called calc, and 8 is the parameter. Okay. And this function calc has been written in JavaScript. Okay. So here we are speaking about proper programming. Okay. So here I have my calculate.js. You can see my calc function, which take one parameter, and is doing some stuff with it. Okay, so that's obviously much more advanced. So that's one way of having something dynamic on your website. You are going to call some JavaScript functions, and within your HTML, you are going to call those functions. Okay, so in your head, you say, here is a file with all the functions I'm interested in. And in your text, you are going to put some JavaScript commands and automatically will retrieve the function in the file. Okay. The second way of adding some dynamic stuff is to use another language, which is called PHP. So let's look at my web page. Where is it? Where is the link to my web page? Here. Okay, so here I have JavaScript, and what is fabulous about that web page? It gives me the weather here and now. Okay, so I didn't write in the web page in HTML, in London the temperature is 12 degrees. No, no, it's going to retrieve it automatically from a website, which is that website actually. It's a Yahoo website. 13 now. So maybe if I read.
That's our current page, that's London.
It's. Oh no, no, that's. Yeah, why is it slightly different?
The high was 13, but the low was 11, so it averaged out.
Yeah, maybe it's, or maybe it's the hourly forecast. Not quite. Okay. So you need to believe me on that one. So you can see that last time when I created that slide, the temperature was 7. Okay, so in this case, the file is in, first of all, the suffix has changed, okay? It's not .html anymore, it's PHP, so it's a bit special, okay? Again, there are some functions which are going to process the information, okay? It's not straightforward. You can see that here in my HTML, I'm going to that website, weather, Yahoo API. I'm going to collect some information. So, and this is information. So I'm going to retrieve all the weather information. And then I'm on my website, I just decide to display what I feel is important. Okay, because they provide the time, the weather, the latitude, it's cloudy and stuff. So in those functions, I'm just selecting what I'm interested in. For example, it provides the temperature in Fahrenheit and Celsius. I'm interested in Celsius. Okay. So again, it looks a bit like JavaScript. Okay. The coding itself, you are using functions and typical structure of a programming language. And what I'm using is called an RSS, Okay. Rich site summary. So that's those websites create web feeds. Okay. So they have a special format, and they provide that to users. Okay. So Yahoo provides you feeds about the weather. They will provide you feeds about football results, about the latest. The BBC will give you feeds about the latest news, about the latest. Some sites will give you about the latest gossips, everything you are interested or not interested in. Okay. So using those feeds, interpreting them and displaying them on your website, allow you to have this dynamic effect. Okay. You have some information about here and now. Which makes your website more interesting and updated. However, now that we have learned about the right button, you know, you say, okay, yeah, that's very cool. There is a way of getting the temperature. I don't want to bother about reading about how to do it. Let's just look at the code of that file. I'm going to copy it for my website. Okay. So I use my right button, view source, and I look at current weather, and it's written 12. So it's not my original file. Okay. So that's a trick somehow, which is important to understand. Is that, where is my, when you are working with PHP, your client, your web browser, is asking for a page. If this page is in PHP, it's not possible for your browser to understand PHP. Okay. So if I go and take my PHP file, which is here, that's what the browser does with it. It just shows it as text. It doesn't understand it. Your browser doesn't understand PHP. Okay. So what happens is that you are asking for a web page. Bad luck, this web page is in PHP, which means that you cannot understand it. So the web server is going to translate it for you. So it's going to take this PHP file and it's going to process it. You say, oh, you want to have access to the temperature, I'm going to the Yahoo, I collect the information, it's 13 degrees, and now I'm going to create an HTML file with where I'm going to put 13. So it's going to do all that processing on the server, access some databases and so on, and out of that create an HTML file that is going to send you. Okay? So you will never have access to the PHP file because it's never sent to you. What is sent to you is the interpretation of the PHP file. So it has many advantages. It means that the computer doing all the work is not yours, it's the server. The server is going to connect to all those databases. You don't have to bother about that. And you just get the result. The negative point is you will never be able to know how to do it. You cannot use your right click and say, what is the code for doing this very nice function? You cannot spy on it, you just get the outcome. Okay. So JavaScript, you can see everything, but it's processed on your machine, and it's not going to go and look for data outside, because it's on your machine. PHP, it's able to go outside, but it interprets everything and sends it back to you. Okay. So the two works in a very different manner. Obviously, website designers using PHP, what they do, they create a PHP server on their machine. So they install PHP on their machine so that they can process PHP on their machine instead of using a third party. Okay. But you don't need it. You just upload your PHP file on the server space that you have bought, and automatically they are going to do all the work for you and send you back the HTML. Okay? I mean, we obviously we'll go back through about this concept when we'll speak specifically about PHP and JavaScript, but they are very important for you to understand at this stage. Okay, so now if we go back to WordPress, so there are many themes, and one of them is called the Simpla theme. So that's how it looks like. And when you choose that theme, it's going to upload a bunch of files on your server. And you can see already that it's in PHP. All the files are with the suffix PHP. The style is in CSS. And then there's even a directory with images. Okay. So if we go on here, so here you have Simpla. So you have some images which are not very exciting, unfortunately. It's this sign, okay. Okay, so not very exciting images. I mean, they are 1K, so they are just equivalent of bullet points, let's say. So the images, but you may want to change them. Okay, if you have used a Simpla file, you don't like the fact that they use this icon, replace the D image and you will have personalized it. You have this CSS file. Okay. So you can see what kind of fonts they are using, what kind of color. So here, colors, they are using numbers. In order to represent colors instead of keywords, okay, but not too difficult to find out what color it is, and they give you about sizes and about header, footers, and how are the headers and so on, okay. So it means that now that if you have uploaded one of those styles from WordPress, you can change it quite easily by editing the CSS. You can edit the CSS without problem, you can change the images without problem. However, now you have also a lot of PHP. And that may be a bit more complicated because you cannot read PHP yet. Okay. So I wouldn't advise tweaking the PHP at this stage, but you cannot already go with the CSS and with the images. But eventually, that's what we want you to be able to do. Okay. You create a website using a professional environment, get all the files, and then personalize it in order to your need or your customer's need. Okay, so that was the CSS page, and that's the PHP page that we will worry about later on. Okay, so now you have all the basics for creating your own web page. So I want you to create a web page from scratch. Okay, so scratch means use a text editor. Don't use any environment which has been outside. Okay. So if it looks rough and ugly, it's likely that you have done it the correct way. Okay. Like mines. Okay. You have seen mines. So I would expect something of the same level. Nothing very complicated. At most 50 lines of codes. Okay. And so create a web page, a bit of content. I have specified what type of content I want. I want a picture, I want a video, I want a bit of text, maybe a link. And I want you to investigate about CSS. Okay. Because I'm going to provide you with some style sheets. And I want you to use them and try to do interesting things with them. Okay. To help your learning, there are two very good websites that I would recommend. You have W3 Schools. It's nice, it's very interactive, it's based on quizzes. And you have Code Academy, which is a fantastic environment. You code and live, you see the outcome of your code. So it's a fantastic environment. You can make all the mistakes you want, you will see the outcome. I mean, it's about making mistakes. If you want to learn, you have to make mistakes. Okay. And so if you want to be serious about HTML and CSS, I would go there and spend a bit of time because you will learn enormously. And that's it. So best of luck for next week. Hoping that you will enjoy creating your basic website. Next week that will be Pushpa, which will be coming back. Thank you.